Hi, my name is Murthy Opmaka. I'm an applications engineer for Keysight Technologies. In this video, I will discuss the most important considerations for a phased array system design. I used a simulation and modeling tool called SystemVue to illustrate various steps in a phased array system design. At the end, you will be able to download the SystemVue workspaces I used in the video. How is the far field of a phased array computed? Traditionally, if we know the complex voltages or current waveforms at the input of each of the radiators in a phased array, we can compute the far field by summing them at a faraway distance. We typically build the schematic with the number of RF channels equal to the number of array elements and simulate each channel individually. If we have a large array, simulating these voltages can take significant amount of time. You can see how this time grows in the graph shown here with the size of the array. This translates to a 20 hours of simulation for a 256 element phased array, scanning over plus minus 20 degrees in azimuth and plus minus 10 degrees in elevation with 1 degree resolution. Fortunately, the tool used here has a technique that makes the simulation run several orders faster. To use this technique, we just need to construct one schematic and simulate any arbitrary sized array. For example, even a 10,000 element phased array simulates in 2 seconds. With this kind of speed, the earlier 256 element array example will simulate in just 14 minutes. Having this technique makes the phased array design a lot more efficient and fun. To begin, let us first understand heuristically how a phased array works. If we place a set of omnidirectional radiators along a line and observe the waves emanating from them in all directions, we can easily notice that the waves add coherently in some directions, not so coherently in some other directions, and incoherently in other directions. This creates a distinct pattern at a faraway distance from the array where it becomes independent of distance. This pattern will have a main lobe, several side lobes, and a back lobe. The pattern is called far field pattern. A three-dimensional far field pattern of a 20 by 20 rectangular array can be seen here. The far field pattern and its characteristics are of utmost importance to baseband designers, RF designers, and antenna designers in a phased array system design. The key parameters of a phased array architecture are the number of elements, distance between elements which is usually less than lambda by 2, the geometry of array such as uniform linear, uniform rectangular, circular, etc., the frequency of operation, and finally, the far field pattern of individual elements. By choosing these parameters judiciously, we can arrive at a desired far field pattern. How does a far field pattern affect overall system performance? Let us consider a simple example. A base station is sending signals to 4 users through 4 distinct beams. In this case, the base station is operating in a shared array mode where all 4 users are utilizing all the elements of the array. Let us measure the quality of the signal received by user 1 in terms of constellation and error vector magnitude. Since we made everything in this system ideal, we expect a very good constellation and low EVM. But that does not seem to be the case here. We wonder why this is so. Purely by virtue of the architecture of the array, a side lobe of user 2 is pointing in the same direction as the main lobe of user 1. Hence, user 1 is receiving not only the desired signal, but also an interferer from user 2. At this point, the problem can be fixed by increasing the signal to interference ratio, by increasing the power of the user 1 signal, or reducing the side lobe level of user 2, or increasing the number of elements of the array, which will increase the gain of the array, as well as produce lower side lobes. As we have seen in this example, The far field pattern has a significant influence on the performance of the system. Before we go further, let us break and then learn a few interesting facts. In the early days of World War I, they used acoustic waves to form a phased array, as you can see here. And in the modern world today, the largest phased array is a project called SystemVue for US Air Force. And you can see that the transmit array has 36,000 antenna elements, whereas the receive array has 86,000 antenna elements. You can also see that the canopy covering the transmit and the receive buildings is actually a radome. And you can also observe the calibration tower to see how they calibrate these two huge phased arrays. If you're interested, you can go to this website and then probe further. I hope you like these facts. Having understood the importance of the far field and its characteristics, we need to understand various factors that influence the far field pattern as part of the design process. The subsystem characteristics and the integration of the subsystems can have profound influence on the far field pattern. I'm going to talk about several critical factors that influence the far field pattern. AM to PM of the amplifiers in the RF electronics, the number of bits of the digital phase shifter and the digital attenuator in the TR module, active impedance of the antenna elements, which interestingly can be a function of frequency and scan angle, and finally, random antenna element failures. I'm going to discuss about all these four factors and their influence on the far field pattern. Let us first understand the AM to PM of the amplifier on the far field pattern. As the input power to the amplifier is increased, the phase change the signal undergoes through the amplifier is no longer a constant. Most phased array designs use amplitude distribution at the antenna elements to control the side lobe levels. This means the amplifiers in various channels feeding to the antenna elements will be operating at different power levels when amplitude tapering window is applied across the array. We see the far field pattern with and without AM to PM effect here. The side lobe levels and their shape and the number all change with AM to PM. By plotting the 2D cut pattern, we can easily measure the side lobe levels. We can see a 5 dB raise in side lobe level and 1.6 dB drop in directivity. Next, let us study the influence of number of bits of the digital phase shifter and attenuator on the far field pattern. The phase distribution and the amplitude distribution of the signal arriving at the antenna elements are achieved by programming these digital phase shifters and digital attenuators. The digital control word length is limited usually to 3 to 6 bits. It is interesting to see how the far field pattern varies with the bit precision of these components. The plot here shows a comparison between unlimited bits, 5 bits, and 3 bits phase shifters and attenuators. The 3-bit precision clearly increased the number of side lobes and their levels. We can see more details in a 2D cut pattern. We can see that the 3-bit phase shifters and 3-bit attenuators narrowed the beam width by 5 degrees and increased the side lobe levels by almost 25 dB. The active reflection coefficient of the antenna is very important, especially if it mismatches with the electronics preceding each element. I mentioned earlier that the active impedance can change with scan angle as well as frequency. So we have to monitor the far field performance while scanning the azimuth and elevation in a range in which the phased array is expected to function. We see here both the 3D plots and the 2D cut pattern. It is clearly noticeable that the active impedance of the antenna mismatching with the electronics in front of it raises the side lobe level significantly. We also see that the way the pattern impacted depends on the scan angle. Before we conclude, let us go through an interesting and important design step. Phased arrays are attractive because even if a certain number of elements fail, the array will still function, though with a graceful degradation of performance. How do we know which element failures and how many failed elements are acceptable before the system is declared to be unacceptable? This can be a difficult question to answer without a simulation tool, but thankfully, we can perform a Monte Carlo simulation by randomly failing a fixed number of elements, or we can attribute a probability of failure to each element. We can easily see here that the side lobe levels degrade the performance with random failure of the elements. Finally, we gained an understanding of what impacts the far field pattern, which in turn influences the system performance. We just learned that it is absolutely essential to be able to simulate the array very quickly, as we have to explore a lot of design space. In addition, sometimes the array can be very large. Studying beamforming architecture and techniques is very interesting, and I hope you enjoyed learning along with me in this video. You can download the SystemVue workspaces I used from the link below for your own use. Thank you for watching this video.